Did you all enjoy praise and worship? Amen. Man, if you didn't, something was wrong with you. Glory to God. Amen. This praise team is either they all got saved at one time or they just sang, sounding better than me. Glory to God. Billy Carroll said, y'all got saved at one time. Praise the Lord. Proverbs, the 18th chapter. I want you to thank our listeners, wherever you are. Thank God for you all being a part of today's service. As always, it is our prayer that something will be said that will bless your life in a tremendous way. Proverbs, the 18th chapter. I want to look at verse 20 and 21. Are you there? It says, a man's belly shall be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth, and with the increase of his lips shall he be satisfied. Death and life are in the power of a tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Yes, sir. Help me preach and look at the person by the temple and say, neighbor,
what you say
can be used
to
help you. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, thank you, Father, for this time of your word. Father, it is our sincere prayer that you would speak through us, think through our minds. Yeah. In the name of Jesus, we bind the hand of the adversary that would come to steal, kill, and destroy. Yeah. And Father, we release your word into this house. God, today, let it fall on good ground. We bless your name and give you maximum glory. It's in Jesus' name that we do pray. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may have your seat in the presence of our Lord. Bring me up just a little bit. Where you get to go? Just a little bit more. Amen. Now, I know this isn't the lesson we left off with on the last time, but if you were here on Wednesday night, listen, if you were not here, you missed a great lesson on Wednesday night.
Amen.
The word was rich. I encourage you to get a copy of a CD or DVD of Wednesday night's lesson. It was a powerful lesson on Wednesday. And so I felt prompted in my spirit to pick up part two of this lesson that we started on Wednesday night and pick it up on this morning. Because listen, by the time the new year rolls around, I want things changing in your life.
Amen.
Amen. How many of y'all want things changing in your life?
Amen.
Tell a person by saying, I expect change in my life. Amen. I believe that the Spirit of the Lord wants to do some great and mighty things in our lives, and things will happen as we make the changes necessary in our lives to cause things to change. Amen?
Amen?
Now, if you were here on Wednesday night, I told them that many Christians use the words of their mouths, and they use the words of their mouths against them. And understand, if you and I use the words of our mouths, Brother Corey, against us, understand we cannot blame the devil for some of the things that transpire in our lives.
Amen.
And I told them on Wednesday night that many times, Brother Reyes, the devil gets blamed for a whole lot of stuff. Now, mind you, I am not on the side of the devil, but if I were his lawyer, I promise you I could defend him. Because many of us get our own selves in trouble by the words of our mouths. Ask the person by and say, what you been saying lately? The Bible says that we are snared. Watch this now. The Bible says we are snared or trapped by the words of our mouths. We're simply saying that what happens is that when we open our mouths, we create a door or a segue whereby the enemy can come into our lives, you all, and trap us. And we are the ones who give the devil permission to come and bombard our lives. And because we open the door, now our job is to pray and ask God to shut the door that we've opened up. And understand, children of God, if you're not careful, many of the things that's transpiring in our lives, when you invite the devil in, he is more than happy to show up in your life.
Amen.
I'll say that again. When we invite him in, he is more than happy to show up in our lives. The Bible said, the thief coming out, Jesus said in John 10:10, the thief coming out but for to steal, kill, and destroy. And so anytime there is a death cycle operating in your life, it is not that God brought it in. It is a evil enemy, and many times we are the ones who invite him into our lives, and if you don't shut the door, he's going to come and ultimately destroy your life.
Amen.
Tell a person about it, say,
you must shut the door.
Now understand, in our lives, if things are going to change, and I fully expect them to change, then we are the ones who are the agent of change.
Yes.
Somebody say, I'm the agent of change.
Of change.
The Bible says that our mouth or your tongue is like a rudder. How many of you all know what a rudder is? Not a gutter, a rudder.
All right.
A rudder is a little small thing on the back of a boat. In this little small thing, you would wonder how this little small thing can cause a great big old ship to turn. Well, what causes the ship to turn is that at the back of the boat, someone now takes a wheel and turns this little bitty rudder, and now this little rudder goes against the current of the water. And as this current or as the water hits this rudder, the current will cause the boat to turn ever so slowly. What happens is many times you don't often or always feel the turn. But somebody say it's turning. Now, here's how the devil often gets us, you all. It's because we don't always see it or we don't always feel it, we become discouraged because we don't always see or feel or notice the change right away. But encourage the person by telling them, say, it's still turning.
It's still
now, I told you on Wednesday night that I was going to show you that, how once you open your mouth, that your words cause things to happen supernaturally and things happen right away. Come on, Pastor, supernaturally and right away. If you recall, the Bible said Daniel prayed, and when Daniel prayed, God says your prayer or the answer to that prayer that God said, I heard. He said, I released it the moment you prayed it. How many of y'all want God to release your answer the moment you pray it? I'll tell a person by and say, God released it the moment I prayed it. Now, here's the problem in causing you discouragement. It's because you don't see it yet. Is it possible that there is a demonic spirit that's been sent from the pits of hell that has come to hinder or stop or slow the motion of the answer to your prayer? And understand, the devil knows this. Once again, the devil does know this, that if he can hinder your prayer long enough, he'll use your mouth to put a stop to the very answer that was coming in your life. Let me see if I can say it like this. Have any of you all ever been going someplace and you were on your way because of an invitation or something you thought was an invitation? And someone called you and told you, don't come. Now watch this. You were on your way and someone changed the words or changed the invitation and you turned right around and went back. It is not that you were not on your way, but because someone called you and gave you a different set of words, now you reversed your motion and went back to where you came from because of words that were spoken in your life. Well, so it is, family, in our lives, in the spirit realm. You cannot speak death and life at the same time and expect results in your life. I'm going to say it for you again. You cannot speak life and then speak death and expect the life cycle to continue in your life. Tell a person about it, you got to watch what you say. Now, here, family, is what I've noticed. Frustration can make you think some real crazy stuff. Oh, I know maybe it's just your pastor. But I'm going to say it again. Frustration can make you say some crazy stuff. Okay, just so the person by you know it's not just them. How many of y'all have said some crazy stuff out of frustration? Now, the question becomes then, what brings on frustration? What brings on frustration is when things come up in our lives that are contradicting the very thing we're believing for. If you're believing God to heal you and it looked like you got worse, that's called a contradiction. If you're praying and asking God for more money and it looked like the more you pray for money, the broker you get, that's called contradiction. If you're asking God to bring peace in your house and it looked like everything around you started falling apart, that's called contradiction. And how many folks have ever experienced contradictions in your life? And it is, you all, in the middle of those contradictions, follow me now, it is in the middle of those contradictions, God requires you and I to stay focused.
Amen.
Somebody says, stay focused.
Stay focused.
God requires that you and I remain focused while we're in the middle of a contradiction. Because it is in the middle of that contradiction that we will all know whether you believe what you prayed for or whether what you prayed was because you prayed because you were in a desperate situation.
Right.
That's the way you're saying. I'm saying this. Sometimes we pray the will of God And sometimes we pray things out of desperation because somebody else has what we want. And understand, family, you have to always know what the will of God is for your life in order to get the hand of God to move favorably in your life. That's the way you're saying. Because I'm glad that God didn't give me something to pray for. Or maybe it's just me. I say again, I say, I'm glad that something I pray for that God didn't give me. Because there's some things, if God gave me what I asked for, my life could be worse off than it is now. And so we must understand that God, family, knows better what's good for our life than we know for ourselves. Encourage somebody to tell me that
God knows best.
And so this morning, you all, for the course of this series, I want to turn things around and show you that you can use these same principles, the power of your words, and help change your life for the better. Write this down. When I open my mouth, things are happening in the spirit realm that my eyes have not seen yet. When I open my mouth and speak faith-filled words, things are happening in the spirit realm that my eyes have not seen yet. I'll say it again. When you open your mouth, things are happening in the spirit realm that your eyes have not seen yet. Now, I use the word yet cautiously because, understand, you are praying, and many of us have embraced or indoctrinated this world system, and we want it like a microwave or a piece of toast in an oven. You know, anybody ever been hungry and you put some bread in the toaster? And if you're really hungry, that toast seems to take forever to come up.
Yeah.
Maybe it's just me. Come on. You know, cook fast more than 2 days. I challenge you. Fast more than 2 days. And all of a sudden the fast is over with, and now you're really hungry. And you want to start off real slow and put a piece of bread in the toaster, I guarantee you what should have took 35 seconds going to seem to be a whole half hour. Because we have been so trained to do everything instantly. Think about it. You know, the old school mothers, man, I mean, for a good meal, they put that food in a slow cooker.
Yes, sir.
Come on, cook it all night. Get up, go to church, bless God, let it cook while they're praising God. You go home, that little tough steak that came from a cow's, well, you know it came from. It was so tender, it fell right off the bone. Come on, that skirt steak was, it was so juicy and meaty, it fell right off the bone. But now, we want to do everything in the microwave. Come on, those good meals, you notice that what you put in the microwave don't stay hot for a long time? Other day, bless God, Lady Carol made some spaghetti, and she made this good, what was it, some meat sauce? Man, she put that bad boy, oh dear God, I thought I was going, oh Lord, hurt myself. Yeah, I was praying too, girl, help me Jesus. And the first 2 days, she put it in a pot to warm it over again. It stayed hot. Well, day three, she wasn't there, and I was hungry. And so I got my situation, I put it in the microwave. And I thought it was blazing hot, bless God. I got my food, put it on the table in the living room, went back and got my water and got my other stuff. I sat down and it was cold. And I'm trying to figure out how come it's cold now, and I know I put it in there at least 3 minutes. It should have been too hot to eat. Now watch this. See, when things come to us real fast, many times we don't appreciate it. Watch this. Some of y'all are going to buy toys for little June Bug and Shaquita. And they're going to break it before the day is over with. Because they didn't pay for it. Watch this. Have you ever noticed folks come in your house and they don't appreciate your house like you do? Okay, I'm going to say it like you. You go to other folks' house and don't appreciate it like you appreciate your house. I'm working hard already. In your house with your white carpet, you pull off your shoes when you come to the front door. You come in somebody else's house with your dirty feet.
Right.
Your car dirty. You walk through the mud in the dirt. You come right in and put your big old feet on somebody's carpet. Okay, I know that you. If anybody has somebody bring dirt in your house?
Yes.
And you wonder how come you bring dirt in my house, but your floor is real clean? Because you don't appreciate my stuff. Come on, somebody. Many times when God gives us things, and we don't have to wait a long time for it. We don't appreciate the process that God takes us through to get the blessing to our lives. But how many of y'all have ever prayed a long time for something, and by the time it got to you, you didn't want to ever let it go? Oh, tell a person about saying,
God blesses you.
You won't ever let it go.
Now
watch this. I told you that the moment you open your mouth, things begin to happen supernaturally, right? Now watch this. In Matthew the 17th chapter, here it was. Don't turn there. I'll tell you what it said. In Matthew the 17th chapter, Jesus told Peter. He says, Peter, I want you to go fishing. And in the fish's mouth, there is going to be a coin. And when you get the money out of fish's mouth, go and pay my taxes and pay yours. Now watch this. The moment Jesus said that, things or certain things had to happen supernaturally the moment he said it. You're saying, Pastor, where did it happen? First of all, the first thing that had to happen was the fish that is accustomed to eating worms had to acquire a taste for money. Now, you know, and I know, fish generally don't eat money, do they? All of a sudden, the fish had to acquire a taste for money. Watch this. The second thing that had to happen was somebody had to be either on a boat or on a bridge and lose some money. Come on. Now, watch this. When the person who lost that money had to be at the right place, the fish had to show up at the right time to swallow the money that somebody lost off the bridge. Now watch this. Peter now had to leave Jesus and go fishing.
Yes.
Peter now had to go to the right lake with the right net and fish in the right spot. And watch this. He had to fish at the right time, and then he had to catch the fish with the money in his mouth. Now watch this. Everything started at the word Jesus spoke when he said, "Go fishing."
Amen.
Y'all missed that. See, when you're speaking, the devil tells you it's too much to go through. See, you can't say, God, I want to be rich, but stay home with your hands in your pocket. Come on, you can't say, well Lord, I want a wife, but you don't ever go no place where the women are. Sisters, you can't say, God, bring me a husband, but you always hang out with your girlfriend all the time, and one of them crazy. Oh, come on, anybody seen a perfect girl singing all the same time, and I'd have seen y'all, one of y'all tripping. Oh, they got quiet. Let me help y'all out. See, if I was a single man looking for a woman and saying, six of y'all coming through that, if you come in there and one of your homegirls crazy and she loud, and all of a sudden you get loud with her, in my mind, you crazy as she is. I don't want you. Y'all ain't talking back to me.
All right.
Come on. And so the moment you open your mouth, God begins to have things happen supernaturally. You're saying, Pastor, how in the world are these things happening supernaturally? I'll tell you why. Because the Bible says you are a speaking spirit. Come on, class, say,
I am
a speaking spirit. Pastor, where is that in the Bible? Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. God said, and let us make man in our image and after our likeness. Now, the Bible says God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship him how? In spirit and in truth. In other words, when God made man and God blew breath into a man, the Bible, one writer says, man became another speaking spirit.
Amen.
Come on, can I say, I'm a speaking spirit. And so since then, God made you and I in his image, in our likeness, you can't afford to take your words for granted. Okay, how many of y'all have a mirror in your house someplace? How many of y'all ever stood in front of your mirror? All right? How many of y'all, when you combed your hair, the image in the mirror combed his hair too? Oh boy, got so fast today. How many of y'all, when you turn, the image in the mirror turned too? Here's my point. The image does the same thing of the person in authority. If God said, I made you in my image, he said, you can do the same thing I do. Somebody said, I can be God in the earth. Oh, it got quiet. Y'all scared to say it. Come on, say, I can be God in the earth.
earth.
Come on, come on. We're going to send it to everybody and say, I can be God in the earth.
I can be God in the earth.
See, watch this. Even Jesus said, when he was confronted, he said, had not the Bible said, ye are gods?
Amen.
Not big God, not Jehovah,
amen,
but you are God's representatives. Okay, in my mother's house, her and my father, they had me, I was the best child, second child. Don't worry, I'm going to keep on saying it until they get it. Huh? That's right. Don't worry, I already know. Glory to God. Amen, Dolly. Bless you. Bless your heart. Yeah? But watch this. My father had the name. On my birth certificate, I'm a carrier of his name. Watch this. When I got in trouble, one of the reasons he would get me, he said, because you embarrassed, watch this, the name. Are you following me? He said, you acting crazy makes me look bad. Watch this. You not operating in authority makes God look bad. Y'all ain't hear me? When you are afraid to pull a trigger spiritually, you make God look bad. Because watch this. Jesus said, behold, I give unto you power. Somebody say, I have power. He said, I've given unto you power, watch this now, over all the power of the enemy, and nothing by any means shall hurt you. Now, if you don't say what God says, you can have power and still be defeated. I wonder how many of God's children have the power, have the authority, they have dunamis power, but the fuse won't light. Would you tell the person by it's time to blow some stuff up? Come on. When you're mad, your attitude blows up. When you want to give folks a piece of your mind, your mouth blows up. Come on. When you're angry, your text blows up. Why not blow the devil out your life with your words? Come on. And evict the devil out your own house. Would you push the person by and say, evict the devil out of your house? Listen, baby, if you don't want the devil in your house, evict him out your house. Out your house, out your temple, wherever he is. If you don't want him there, then kick him out. How many folks don't want folks trespassing in your house? Listen, anybody ever been in the house and you heard a sound that you hadn't heard before? Come on. Now, those of you who got some help, you said, I wish they would. Come on, besides your pastor, anybody ever say, I wish they would? Come on, you come here, they'll carry you out. Come on, somebody. Come on, I know everybody ain't just carrying knives. Some of y'all packing some Smith & Wesson. Rest of y'all better get you one. Glory to God. Praise God. But watch this. Why will you attack a person who you can see but won't fight back a devil that's just as real as a person? The Bible said your adversary, the devil, watch this now, is as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. Watch this. The devil is after your life. The devil is after your money, after your family. Watch this. He's after your peace. And watch this. He's also after your faith. Because if he can ever get your faith, ever get your confidence, I don't care how saved you are. If the devil ever steals your confidence, you will never be a threat against the devil.
Amen.
Come on, how many folks besides your pastor, you want to tear down the devil's kingdom?
Amen.
But watch this. You can't tear down his kingdom if you're afraid to fight back.
Amen.
Somebody say, fight back.
Fight back.
Now, told you before, and I'll say it again. You can write it down if you want to. I said a death option cannot exist without a life option existing as well. A death option cannot exist without a life option existing as well. I'll say it again. There cannot be a death option without a life option already existing. The devil keeps you held back because he's telling you there's no hope. But I don't care how hopeless it is or may appear, there's always hope somewhere. Pastor, what are you saying? The other day we saw on the news that there was a gentleman who decided he could not wait for the train to go by. Yeah. He decided he was going to go around the railroad crossing. And the sad part was the girl in the car with him, she was killed, he was not. Yes. Now he's in the ER holding on for dear life, but he's still breathing. They say he's in critical condition, but he's still breathing. He can be on a respirator, but as long as he's still breathing, that simply means there's still hope. Anybody know somebody who was at the point of death, but God brought him back? Listen, God, because God is no respecter of person, you can look like you're at the point of death, the point of no return, but as long as there is hope, God has a way of bringing you back. Would you encourage the person by you and tell them that God can bring you back? Listen, there was a man by the name of Lazarus over in John chapter 11. The Bible said he was dead and stinking for 3 days. Now, watch this. Well, by the time Mary and Martha saw him, they said, Lord, watch this now. Lord, had you been here, our brother would not have died. But Jesus understood that he's more than just Lazarus' friend. He said, I am the resurrection. He said, though he were dead, watch this, yet shall he live. Now, they say, Lord, we know in the last day he's going to live. He said, girl, y'all missed it. I mean, the boy going to get up today. Would you encourage the person by them thinking, today is your day to get up? Oh, come on. Is there anybody in the house who can declare, today is my day, I'm getting up. Today is the day I get my faith back. Today is the day I get my peace back. Today is the day I get my faith back. Today is the day. Come on, today is the day. And so what's this? There cannot be a death option without a life option already existing.
Yes.
In Proverbs, in our text, it says, death and life are the power of the tongue. God says there are two options here. There is the death option, and there is the life option.
All right.
The question is, what option will you choose?
All right.
Ask the person by saying, what option will you choose?
What option will you choose?
See, watch this, you all. God will allow what you allow.
Yes,
I'll say it again. God will allow what you allow. If you open your mouth and you invite the death cycle in, God will allow it because you said it. Now watch this. You can't say, well, God, you don't understand. I'm just mad when I said it. The moment you said it, you are the one who supernaturally began to cause things to happen in your life. Are you hearing me? You can't keep saying, I hate going to work. I hate this job. I hate everybody on the job. I hate what they're paying me. I hate having to put on clothes. I just hate it. I hate it. I hate it. You can wake up on the right side of the bed for a change, and all of a sudden, when it's time to go to work, everything in your life begins to change based on what you said a long time ago. Are you following me? And so you and I have to now take charge over our words. Come on, Sam, say, take charge over your words. See, watch this. Ever since the garden, y'all, God has always given man a chance to choose what option he wanted. Even in Genesis, God gave Adam a chance to choose what cycle he wanted to live by. Isn't it amazing? God says, in the garden, there is the tree of life and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. He says, this one will kill you. This one will bless you. This one will kill you. This one will bless you. This one will usher in the death cycle. The day you eat thereof, you shall surely die. And the tree of life. Question. Why did not Adam tell Eve, let's eat from a tree of life and leave this one alone? Think about it. Now, you know, I always say that if when I get to heaven, I might throw Adam out of heaven. Anybody been there? I said, I'm going to throw his tail out of heaven. I know where he's going. But what the Bible says, that when outside influence pointed out how beautiful it looked, it caused him to choose what God told him to not choose. That's the way you're saying. Watch this. The serpent didn't bring the fruit to Eve. His wife did. This is why it does matter who you hang out with. Well, I'm going to say that again. It does matter who you hang out with. Because if someone is leading you outside the boundaries of God's will for your life, many times because we don't see God physically and we appreciate our friends more than we appreciate seeing God, we will choose a different cycle that is outside the boundaries of God's desire for our lives. Somebody say, I better choose God's cycle. And watch this. Adam decided, I'm going to take this fruit, eat this fruit, knowing that God said it's going to kill me. Uh-huh. Now watch this. Many of us do the same thing. We tell God, but God, you don't understand. I was mad, or God, she got on my nerve, or God, things didn't turn out right. Listen, those things are not excuses for saying the wrong things. And I don't know about you all, but I've been on purpose monitoring what I've been saying for the last 3 weeks. Because watch this, I didn't realize how accustomed I was to saying the wrong things in my life. Watch this, I can't stand so-and-so. Anybody, has somebody kind of fly by you like a bat going nowhere? And you said, what, I hope they run up a pole. Now come on, you really don't mean that. Anybody, has somebody cut you off? You call and you say, that fool gonna kill somebody. Yeah. Now, come on. You don't really want them to kill somebody, do you? No. But we say things out of frustration. Okay, let your money get funny. And you got a bill due. Your mouth says, man, look like I ain't gonna ever get ahead. You the one said it. Come on. Let a pain hit your body. You're like, man, I've been suffering this for a long time. I've been suffering. Look like God ain't going to ever heal me. You can't say that and feel some more bias like I'm healed. Right. Watch this. Consider. This ain't how God does it, but consider this. You say, bias like I'm healed. Uh-huh. Here comes the healing. Oh, man, I won't ever get healed. Healing goes back. Oh, Lord, I believe for healing. Here comes healing. All this pain killing me. Healing goes back. Come on, oh dear God, Lord, God gonna bless my life. Here comes the blessing. Almost at you. Oh, I'm always just broke. There you go. Blessing goes back. Come on, because the Bible says, choose ye this day who you will serve. Watch this. You better choose who your mouth gonna serve. Because you can't keep inviting in both cycles. Watch this. Death and life can abide at the same time. Right? But when you choose the life cycle, you now watch this. You're the one who closed the door to the death cycle. Amen. Come on, say, close the door, close the door, close the door. Now watch this. Now, some folk, God, have to remind you that when he blesses you, that the blessing came because of him and not because of you. Yes. See, watch this. Sometimes God has to allow something to hit our lives that we don't like, to remind us to not forget him when we get blessed. Now, Pastor, where is that in the Bible? Look at Deuteronomy, the 8th chapter, verse 18. Watch this. It's a bad thing when God has to remind you, has to remind us to not forget him. As a matter of fact, the mere fact that God has to remind us to not forget him will suggest, watch this, that you forgot him. Watch this. He says, but thou shalt remember the Lord thy God. Watch this. It is he that giveth thee power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant, which he swore unto thy fathers, and it is this day. Pastor, what you're saying, God had to remind his people that I was the one who blessed you. Pastor, what are you trying to say? I'm saying this. Once you begin to walk into the life cycle, don't forget God. Amen. Don't forget God. Because what the enemy wants to do is when God, see, the enemy, oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. God will bless you, but the enemy also will open up a door to bring something in your life that you believe is a blessing, but he'll let me see if I can say it like this. You're praying for a car. But in your heart, you know that if you get a car, you won't ever bring anybody to church. Watch this. Elder Green Temple said, Lord, if you give me a car, I'll pick for them and bring them to church. Now, you know, in your heart, you ain't bringing nobody to church. And the devil will get you, give you a nice car, all nice and shiny. And watch this. Folks be at home. Here it is, almost 10 o'clock. Time for church. Well, you know, I got to watch my car first get it shiny. Now it's 11 o'clock. Well, I got to vacuum it. Now it's 11:30. Well, you know, Pastor's going to say, I'm walking in church late. And you made something else your God. Come on, somebody. Or anybody know folks who make faith their God? And the very thing they pray for, if you watch this, the devil will take the blessing and bless you and use the blessing against you. The Bible says the blessing of glory make it rich and add no sorrow or painful toil. When God blesses you, don't leave God out the equation when God blesses your life. Is there anybody here who can say that when God opened doors in my life, I will never, ever forget God? Watch it now. Write this down. The words of my mouth give me the advantage over the destructive plans of the enemy. The words of my mouth give me the advantage over the destructive plans of the enemy. I'll say it again. The words of my mouth give me the advantage. How many of y'all want the advantage? Woo, tell the person who might say, I have the advantage. Watch this, class. What the advantage means is simply this. I have a strategy that will outwork the strategy of my opponents. I have a strategy that will outwork the strategy of my opponent. When you have the advantage, let me see if I can say it like this. In the 70s, I had this car. It was a Chevy Impala. A 1974 Chevy Impala. On the outside, it looked like any other jacked up Impala. It was lime green, but it had tinted windows. It looked good to me. You can go, ooh, it looked good to me. But see, when I was going to work, Pastor Mark, I was going down Wentworth one day. And here come a young man. He had a Camaro. And he put up on the side of me on the Kennedy King Viaduct. Anybody know where it's at? And he put him on the side. He put his car in neutral, Thomas, and he raised the motor. He went boom, 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 boom. And I'm like, this boy don't know what I'm packing. And so I put mine in neutral. Had the glass packs. I'm a boom, 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 boom. Had on some 60s and some 30s. I said, this boy don't know. He getting ready to lose. I mean, the Camaro had all the hoopla. I only had a Chevy Impala. But what he didn't know, Red, was I had a modified trans under the car. What he didn't know, I had a four-barrel Harley carburetor under the engine. What the boy didn't know, I was spitting juice out. Come on, somebody. I was kicking juice. He didn't know it. So the Philip, when the light turned green, he took off and I took off right with it. Boom! I shot right by him with my 1974 Chevy Impala. In lime green Impala. I couldn't wait till the very next stop sign. Brother Ben, I pulled the car over. And I said, you want to try it again? To hear my point. See, he saw was a piece of junk. He thought it wasn't going to run. But what he didn't know was that under the hood, I got an unfair advantage. I come to tell you, because you are God's child, God has given you an unfair advantage. Somebody say, favor ain't fair. I know I heard, so I put a thing down. Let go of my car. That's it right there. Woo, glory to God. I found my own car. Praise the Lord. Boy, bless your heart. Look at you. Pull that thing that far back again. See what this? Your words, because you are a child of God, your mouth gives you an unfair advantage. The devil is always bringing things in your life to make you think you can't win. But when you know you have the advantage, watch this now, what you will do is fill your your mouth full of faith words. Come on, say, my words must be filled with faith. Come on, can I say, my words must be filled with faith. Come on, say, my words must be filled with faith. Tell the person, I say, your words must be filled with faith. Now watch this. Your faith is working whether you use it for good or for bad. Your faith is still working. If you use it negatively, it's still working. If you use your faith properly, it's still working. Pastor, what you're saying? There was a man in the Bible who asked God to help him win a battle. He said, Lord, if you let me win the battle, watch it now. He said, the first thing that comes out of my house, I'm going to sacrifice it and give it to you. Yes. Here's the girl, the man, he went home after they won the battle, and the first person out the house, watch this, was his daughter. The only girl he had, and now watch this, the man now has to kill his daughter because he opened his mouth and made a vow to God. Yes. Now watch this now, God honored what he said, and the man had to go back and do what he said because he said so. Amen. See, whenever you make a vow to God, your job is to honor God by doing what you say. Are you following me? This is why the Bible says it is better to not make a vow than to make a vow and defer to pay it. God said, I would rather you not even make one to me. Okay, I'm going to say it like you said. God, get me out of this mess. I'll never do it again. How many folk besides me did it again? We all lie. We all lie. God says, don't make the vow. Because if you make the vow, I would rather you not make a vow, watch this, and ask me for help than to make the vow and then don't pay it. Are you following me? When you understand that your mouth gives you the advantage over the devil, watch this. When the devil thinks he's got you down, you can just start talking and things will start changing. Come on, say, when I talk, the devil must listen. Come on, can I say, when I talk, the devil must listen. Watch this. Give me Isaiah 54. Isaiah 54. Are you all being blessed so far? Watch this. Isaiah said, no weapon that is formed against me shall prosper. Watch this. Look at me. Isaiah says, weapons in your life will be formed, but they won't work. But then he turns right around and says, and every tongue that rise against me or against thee in judgment, thou shalt condemn. Now watch this. Why did Isaiah use the word every tongue? What comes out of your mouth? Words. In other words, he says, someone is somewhere, watch this now, plotting with their mouth against you. And when someone use their words against you, he says, if you condemn it, watch this now, with your words, then their words won't work. Oh, y'all missed that. See, you can't sit back and let folk use their words against you. If you don't open your mouth and begin to say something, you're the one who give their words more credibility than your words. But God said, if you open your mouth, then their words against you won't work because, watch this, you condemn what they said. That's what you mean. I don't care what folk call you. You can just say, you a lie in Jesus' name. Amen. If folk tell you, you won't ever be successful. That's a lie. Amen. If folk tell you, you won't ever get ahead. That's a lie. Amen. If folk tell you, you won't ever get a house. That's a lie. If folk tell you, you won't ever get you a wife. That's a lie. And folks say, you will always be like that. That's a lie. Because watch this, my words must override what you are saying. Because watch this, in judgment, I condemn what you say. Maybe just because he left you and told you, you won't ever find nobody. Listen, I release a word in your life. You're going to find somebody who's better than the joker who left you. Oh, somebody should say anything like that. Because sometimes when folk go out your life, they'll bring you down to you think you're the one at fault. But how many folk know that just because somebody leaves you don't mean you're the one at fault? Maybe let folk go out your life. I know who God called me to be. I know who I am in God. And my job is to bring down every word, every idle word that does not line up with God. for my life. Somebody said you better say something. Now watch this. When you and I understand the words that are powerful in our mouths, and we understand that once we open our mouths, things begin to happen, that simply means the advantage goes to me. How many of y'all ever watch tennis? In tennis, if the person on one side scored, or if the game is tied, a person scores on one volley, it's an advantage Serena. First of all, if you're playing Serena, it's an unfair advantage anyway. That girl just, she all in, and two bag of chips. I'm just telling the truth. I wouldn't play her. I'd be like, Jesus. But watch this. That's the way the devil should be doing you. When he hits sickness at your life, you'll be bawling right there with you. I'm healed. All right. Come on. Amen. You ought to send it right back from where it came from. Yeah. Right. But now watch this. If you don't open your mouth, one of the reasons we don't open our mouth is because we don't believe our words have power. All right. The Bible says we believe, therefore we speak. Yes. Which then would suggest the reason I don't speak is because, Thomas, I don't believe. Right. Because we don't do what we believe. And you won't do what you don't believe. Are you following me?
Yes.
Well, go to Mark 11. Mark 11. Watch this now. Look at verse 22. Mark 11. Look at verse 22. Guys, see this.
Okay.
Come on, say, my words have power.
My words.
Come on, because my words
give
me the advantages. Watch this. Mark 11, verse 22. Watch this. Jesus answering and saying to them, have faith in God or have the faith of God. Look at me. What's happening here is that Jesus, you all, had just finished. He was going down a road, and on this road, there was a fig tree. And the fig tree had leaves, but the fig tree did not have any figs.
All right.
And Jesus got angry at the fig tree.
Amen.
Now, as they was going into the temple, the Bible said Jesus cursed the fig tree at the root. Now, watch this. In that he cussed it, he cursed it. Would you inform the person buying the church that they get the difference? He cursed it, he didn't cuss it. He cursed the fig tree. Now, watch this. He said, Bible said he cursed it at the root, Corey. And once he cursed it, when they came out of the temple, Peter saw that the tree he cursed had withered up. And Peter asked the question, Lord, how did you do that? And Jesus says, have the God kind of faith.
Amen.
Now watch this. What he was saying was, I just did what God did.
Right.
Now you were saying, Pastor, well, he was God. Jesus operated, he didn't operate as God, he operated as a man.
Amen.
But he understood he had the God kind of authority.
Right.
Are you following me?
Amen.
Jesus was a man with like passion as you and I, right? But he operated with the authority that he knew he had in his Father. Now watch this. He cursed it from the root. Peter wanted to know, Lord, how did you do what you did? Jesus says, have faith in God. Watch this. Verse 23. For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, watch this now, be thou removed, be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he has said shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Therefore I say unto you, whatsoever things, watch this now, you desire when you pray, believe that ye receive them, and ye shall what? And ye shall have them. Now, let's ask the scripture some questions. I'm going to give you six things that that's on the text, or six questions you want to ask the scripture. How many of y'all understand that if you want to learn what the Bible means, you have to ask the Bible questions?
Amen.
Right? Now watch this. Question number one, you should ask the text. What does it mean to have faith in God? Number two, you should ask, what is my personal responsibility? Number three, you want to say, what mountain is Jesus referring to? Number four, you want to ask, do I have the authority to tell a mountain where to go? Number five, you should ask the question, how do I keep doubt out of my heart? Number six, you want to ask the question, how do I create a system of belief that is impenetrable? Did you all get all six? If not, get the CD. I'm moving on. Let's do number one. Number one is, what does it mean to have faith in God? Come on, class, say, what does it mean to have faith in God? I got 10 minutes. I'm going to give it to you. Break it down. Faith in God means to have total confidence in the ability of God to come through for you, especially in troubled times. I'll say it for you again. Faith in God means to have total confidence in God's ability. If you have that underlined, in God's ability. In God's ability to come through for you, especially in troubled times. Now, I use this word troubled times on purpose. Because when things are going okay, we generally don't even look to God as much as we should. But everybody in here looks to God when things get tough. Maybe it's just your pastor. How many folks know that it's easy to become complacent when things are going good? Come on, when all your bills are paid, your light bill is paid, your phone bill is paid, come on. Everything, your car paid off, and when you have no bills, it's easy to become complacent. Okay, when you just got a good raise, you can drive the car you want to drive, you can do whatever it is you want to do, it's easy to become complacent. But a whole lot of folk get sick with God. When they ain't got no money, they ain't got no friends, they calling everybody to get a rat to church, please. They call an Uber, they call a Lyft, and then try to borrow $3. Come on, folk always want to tell God, make God all these promises when they're broke. But you have to own purpose, though, that God has the ability, whether you are in good times or in bad times. Amen. Pastor, why is that? Because how many full of the bad things happen to good people? Yes. Watch this. Because you are saved, sanctified, speaking in tongues, does not exempt you from trouble. Job said, a man born of woman, they are few and they are full of trouble. So in other words, trouble or you being a Christian does not exempt you from trouble. But our faith, watch this, our faith is in God's ability to bring us out of all trouble. Watch this, go to 1 John 5. 1 John chapter 5. Look at verse 14. The Bible says, and this is the confidence we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he what, class? Yes. Look at me. The Bible says, if we ask anything according to his will, here's the question. How do you know his will? Come on, class. How do you know his will? Watch this. He will either give you a rhema or a logos. A rhema or a logos. That's what you're saying. He'll either speak it or he'll write it. Now, God never says anything out of the boundaries of his written word. And so if you're hearing voices in your head that don't line up with God's word, that's not God. See, you know, Ms. Gina, I'm afraid of folks who always say God said. Those folks make me itch. I'm scared of them, folks. Now, especially y'all in the black church. Because what they're really saying is, don't challenge what I'm doing. When folk, watch this. When folk leave your church, they're going to say, oh, the Lord is taking me someplace else. Now, how come the Lord couldn't make me be on time for church? You mean God can keep you from lying in church? You wouldn't stop stealing in church, but now God leading you someplace else. What you should be saying is, I'm lying and I want to go. But for you, the clause, God told me that, you know, God ain't talked to you in a long time. Matter of fact, God, the last conversation you and God had was God told you to get yourself together. Before you the word God said, what it means is don't question what I'm doing. But see, they didn't mean, the Bible said, try the spirit and see it whether it be of God. Because God said that some things folks say are lies. Amen, somebody. This is why you better judge. And folks tell you God said, you better judge it. I won't say it again. When folks say God said, you better judge what folks say. Come on, yeah, God told me, like, come on, you ain't praying, you ain't fasting, you ain't been in the Word. Come on, God said, why in the world would God give you to tell somebody anything when God can't get you to get right?
That's right.
All right. Oh, I think you have to cry out there. Get pointed out. I'll move on in something else. But watch this. Our confidence in God comes that we know we act according to His will.
Yes, yes.
Whenever I ask God for anything, I must know it's the will of God for my life. Uh-huh. Are you following me? I don't have to ask God for a spaceship. I don't ever plan to go out of space. Come on, I don't care how bad the air get. They can say it's life on Mars. We can go there. I ain't going. Now, some of y'all might say, Pastor, I'm going, but bye. I see you in heaven someplace. The only time I'm coming close to outer space is in the rapture. Are you following me? Other than that, I ain't going. I ain't going ever pray, God. I'm in a rocket. Are you hearing me? When you pray, what gives you and I the faith to believe God for things is when we know we're praying according to His will. Now, watch this. When the last time you prayed, did you pray according to God's will or did you pray according to your emotion? Because sometimes we pray and we're praying the problem instead of the answer. And when you pray the problem, watch this, you remain in the problem. Watch this. Watch this. I'm going to pray like you pray. Lord, you know I don't feel good, Lord. You know, Lord, my back is aching, my too tight. You know it. I won't say it. The words came out just this now. And you're praying all these bad prayers, and you're wondering how come God isn't changing things. It's because you are coming in agreement with your reality or your fact when what if the truth of God's word always outweighs the facts of your lives. Are you hearing me? What the Bible says, God says, I already know what things you are in need of. And so God says, you don't have to pray for me. When I pray, you have to pray the answer to the problem, because when I pray the answer, my prayer to the answer says, God, I know the answer already exists.
Yes, yes, yes.
Are you hearing me?
Yes.
The reason I can pray for a healing is because healing exists.
Yes.
I can pray for a blessing because the blessing exists.
Yes.
I can pray for houses and land. You know why? Because houses and land, what class they
yes.
exist. You can pray for what you need because it already exists. Are you following me? And so watch this now. If it's God's will, it may not exist yet. You can pray for it and God give you an idea.
Yeah.
All right.
Oh, okay. Thank you, Holy Spirit. See, you're praying, God, give me some money. And God says, I give you an idea.
All
right.
You think, God, bless my life. God said, I give you an idea.
Yeah.
Okay. What's the guy named Bill Gates? He the guy for Microsoft. Is that him, right? Watch this. Bill Gates had an idea. His idea brought him into wealth. Now you're saying, Pastor, you don't understand, Pastor, I don't have that kind of education. Watch this. You can Google. Your brain have a greater capacity than any computer. Now some of y'all just shut down.
Yeah,
that's a no or don't. Come on. I didn't finish the eighth grade. That's because you didn't want to. I'm going to say it again. Your brain, your mind, is greater than any computer.
Yes.
All right. Pastor, prove it. Watch this. Somebody with a brain made the computer.
Amen.
Are you hearing me? Somebody with a brain had to think to make the computer. And watch this. The person with the same same brain put the information in the computer. Which means then the brain is smarter than a computer. Now, the question is, will you use the capacity to which God has graced you with, watch this, against yourself or for yourself? That man had to write a program that everybody who were using typewriters, back, come on, using that white strip to block out your mistake. He said, no, let's make a computer. And now his great-great-great-great-great-great-grandkids until the earth is gone, gonna all be living real good because watch this, he used his brain to solve a problem. Is it possible you're praying, God bless me, and God says, I'm giving you an idea. I put a talent in your hands. If you use what I've given you, you never again have to pray for a blessing. Use what I've already given you. Would you tell somebody to say, use what God given you? Understand for me, when you and I use what God has already given us, now when we pray, we can pray and direct our prayers in a certain direction, and now our prayers can be prayed with confidence. So John says, and this is the confidence we have in him, that if we ask him according to his will, he hears us. How many folks want to pray and you know God hears you? Oh, that ain't, now watch it now. Don't base God hearing your prayer based on how you feel. I'm going to say it again. Don't base God hearing your prayer on how you feel. Because sometimes you don't feel nothing. Okay, sometimes I pray, I don't feel a thing, Sister Tracy. I don't feel no quickening. I don't feel no shaking. My hand don't go up. I don't cry. I don't speak in tongues. Sometimes I don't feel nothing. Sometimes I feel like I pray and hit the ceiling and bust in my own head. Come on. And sometimes doing all the theatrics, that prayer ain't going to place. Come on. You cannot base your prayer on what your emotions have said to you. What makes your prayer effective that I know I prayed the will of God for my life. I know I prayed the word of God. And when I pray the word of God with my prayer, watch this, it is my faith in God's word that makes my prayer effective. Are you following me? Watch this. Verse 15. He says, and if we know that he hears us, whatsoever we ask, watch this now, I'm done. We know we have the petition we desired of him. Yeah. The reason you can celebrate is because I opened my mouth and I got my mouth in line with God's word. When you pray, is your mouth in line with God's word? I told this y'all on Wednesday night. I'm sorry, I told on the broadcast. Confessing God's word simply says, I agree with God. Come on, can I say, I agree with God? When you and I open our mouth and begin to confess God's word, what I'm doing is telling the devil, I agree with God. He's going to tell you, you don't feel it. You don't see it, but watch this. You don't have to see it or feel it. Your job is to agree with God. Now, the Bible says, if any two of you shall agree on earth, as touching anything, it shall be done. Now, watch this. You and God are majority. Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. God by himself is a majority. Oh, yeah. But watch this. God needs me, or he desires that I come in agreement with him. Would you encourage the person by saying, you must come in line with God? Now, y'all, that's powerful. Now. I'm done. You must come in line with God. You must purposely bring your mouth in line with God. This morning, I was telling Lady Carol, I said, Lord, sometimes folk need to pass the Superman. And anything pastor don't ever hurt. She said, Pastor, you hurting? I said, I don't want to say nothing. But I was hurting. But I can't come tell you I'm hurting. You know why? Because if I say, y'all know what, Pastor don't feel that, but I'm sure hurting. Soon I want to say, Pastor, me too. You will. I guarantee you. I said, Gina, girl, last night, I slept rough last night, man. I tossed and turned. I slept bad. My back hurt. My feet hurt. My head hurt. You don't say, Pastor, let me tell you what. Come on. Now I got a whole story. But see, watch this. What I did was I used my words to bring you into doubt. Are you following me? You got to be careful about bringing your mouth in line with other folk who are in doubt. I mean, I'm cool now. I feel good. Like James Brown, I feel good. Come on. Pain free. But watch this. I couldn't let it come out my mouth. I had to agree with God. Now watch this. I had to agree with God until, watch this, until my body came in line with my confession. Come on, hear me, class. When you agree with God, you keep saying it until that thing comes in line with what you're believing for. Now, I can tell you up front, on a scale of 1 to 10, I'm about an 8. But I kept saying what God said. I'm healed. I kept saying, I ain't hurt no place. Now, Lady Carol said, what did you hurt? I wouldn't tell her. I wouldn't tell her because I refused to let my mouth agree with the pain. Are you following me, somebody? Come on. You got to keep on saying, I don't care how you feel. Come on. But Pastor, I'm going to fake it till I make it. No, I'm going to say it till I get there. Are you hearing me? You got to learn how to change your situation by the words of your mouth. And if you don't like what you're seeing, then start saying something different. Come on, somebody. But Pastor, I've been saying it already 2 weeks. Well, guess what? Keep on saying it 2 more weeks. When those done, been there yet, keep on saying it 2 more weeks. Come on, somebody. You got to say it until you see it. Come on, Pastor. You got to say it until you see it. Help me, family. Your words can help you. Your words can help you or hurt you. And we have for too long used our words to hurt ourselves. We use our words to bring destruction in our lives. Use our words to call our kids and keep acting the same crazy. Because you keep saying, that boy keeps getting on my nerve. That's why he keeps getting on your nerve. Because you keep saying that. Are you hearing me? Listen. What's wrong with saying my kids are the head and not the tail? Come on, my kids are above only, not beneath. Come on, how about, watch this, how about prophesying over your kids' life every day? Follow me. It's the little things, the small things. Come on, even that car you got, even if it's a hoopty. We're talking about, but when this thing gonna break down. Every day you pray for that car, say, Lord, I think this car will not break down. Are you hearing me? Right now, I'm at 100 and almost 170 miles. I said, Lord, I thank you. It ain't breaking down. Amen. Come on, somebody. I say it every day.
Yes.
Come on, it run good. I test it every day to make sure. I put it on 80, 85 every day, glory to God, to make sure. Amen. I do to make sure it run good. Watch this. I don't expect my car to break down. When I get rid of it, it's because I just have to trade it in. Amen. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Because, listen, I put my hand on it. I pray for it, and I believe what I say. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
I believe that ain't no burger going to ever break in my house.
Yes.
Amen. Come on, somebody.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. I believe that none of my kids will ever die if he went to a death.
Yes.
You know why? Because I speak that over their mind. Come on.
Yes.
Are you hearing me?
Yes.
It is not that the devil won't try, but because of my faith and my faith-filled words, my words have authority. And when you understand that your words have authority, then you will start speaking the right thing out of your mouth and use those same